In the previous lecture, we have discussed about the balanced slope detector, wherein we have seen that we are using two single slope detector connected back to back, and we are getting the advantage for the better linearity or more linearity than the single slope detector. Now in this lecture, we will continue with the second method of the FM demodulation, which is called as Foster-Seeley discriminator. What is the basic difference between Foster-Seeley and single slope and balanced slope detector is that the Foster-Seeley discriminator is a kind of phase detector, and throughout the working we will be talking about the phase between the current and the voltage. And that is why this particular discriminator is different from the previous balanced slope detector and single slope detector, because they are detecting the frequency changes and this particular circuit is going to detect the change in the phase. And that is why how the Foster-Seeley discriminator is different from the single slope detector is that in the Foster-Seeley discriminator, all the tuned circuit are tuned to the same frequency. So in the previous balanced slope, we have seen that upper tuned circuit was tuned to FC plus delta F, lower tuned circuit was tuned to FC minus delta F, and that is what we had highlighted as the disadvantage of the balanced slope detector, that it is very difficult to tune all the three circuits at the different tuning frequency, and that disadvantage is avoided in the Foster-Seeley discriminator. And the circuit diagram of the Foster-Seeley discriminator will be similar to that of balanced slope detector, except some of the changes. And apart from that, we are getting the advantage of the better linearity than the slope detection in the Foster-Seeley discriminator. So this is the circuit diagram for the Foster-Seeley discriminator. We will start from now extremely right hand side, because at the input side there are some changes, but output side is common. So what is the output side? This D1, C1, R1 is going to form our envelope detector 1. D2, C2, R2 is going to form our envelope detector 2, and the output is taken across this particular point. At the input side, what are the changes made is the FM input is given to a transformer. And now you can see here, there is one coupling capacitor CC, which is coming from input to the center tapping of transformer. And then it is coming to one inductor. So we can say that the input voltage will be coming through this particular capacitor, and that particular will be appearing across this particular inductor. And that is why it is written that VL3 is equal to Vin, because input voltage is appearing here. As you can see, this particular transformer is a center tap. So if we use this particular as an inductor LA, this inductor as LB, because of the center tapping action, VLA, voltage across LA and voltage across LB, is going to be 180 degree out of phase. There is only one capacitor connected. As we said, that Foster-Seeley discriminator is a phase discriminator, and our tuned circuits will be tuned only to a single frequency, and that is why we have this particular capacitor C. So these are the changes which is done in the balanced slope detector circuit diagram, and the diagram for the Foster-Seeley discriminator is designed. Now few observations which I would like to make from the diagram, so that the working of this particular discriminator will be very clear. So once again, you can see in the diagram that input capacitor, coupling capacitor CC, is coupling the input from input to this particular inductor L3, and because of that, input voltage appears across L3. VLA and VLB are 180 degree out of phase, and there is a diode D1, D2, C1, C2, R1, R2. They are acting as an envelope detector. Now few observations from the circuit, which I already told right now. Voltage VLA and VLB are going to be 180 degree out of phase with each other. And the same voltage, whatever voltage is going to be appearing is in the secondary, that is going to be 90 degree out of phase with each other. Therefore, the voltage VLA and VLB are 180 degrees out of phase with each other, and this particular voltages are in quadrature with the VL3. And therefore, from the diagram, this VLA, VLB are 180 degree out of phase, and both these will be 90 degree out of phase with this particular L3. And this is how we are going to draw the phasor diagram in the upcoming slides. So these particular points are very important to understand and to remember. Voltage across top of the diode, if we can again see the diagram, the voltage across diode D1 is going to be vector sum of VLA and VL3, whereas the voltage across diode D2 is going to be vector sum of VLB and VL3, and that is what is another observation which can be made from the circuit diagram. So voltage across top of the diode D1 is VL3 and VLA, and voltage across bottom diode VD2 is sum of VL3 and VLB. And another important point which is to be made here is the output voltage is going to be difference between the capacitor voltage 1 and capacitor voltage 2, which is equal to VC1 minus VC2. So these are the few observations which are made from the circuit diagram, that voltages VLA and VLB are 180 degree out of phase, and they both are in 90 degree out of phase with 90 degree quadrature with VL3. The diode D1 is going to be conducted with the help of VL3 and vector sum of VL3 and VLA, and diode D2 is going to be a vector sum of VL3 and VLB. The output voltage will be equal to the capacitor output voltage will be equal to VC1 minus VC2, and that is what is the final output voltage. Now, to understand the working, we will be taking the help of phasor diagram so that whatever observations which are made from the circuit diagram becomes clear. So we will be considering three cases here. So we are considering case one, when the input frequency is equal to the carrier frequency or a center frequency. And as we said that now all the tuned circuits are connected, are tuned to a one frequency, and that particular frequency is called as the resonance frequency. So when input frequency is equal to the carrier frequency, voltage of diode D1 and D2 is equal, and therefore both the diodes will conduct at the same voltage, charging both the capacitor with the equal magnitude. And therefore VC1 will be equal to VC2, and output voltage is equal to VC1 minus VT2, which will be equal to 0. And that particular point you can see in this particular phasor diagram. Now this is what we were talking, that voltage VLA and VLB are 180 degree out of phase. So this is phasor of VLA, this is phasor of VLB, and voltage VIN is 90 degree phase with them. Now if you take a vector of VLB and VN, that will be VD2. If you take vector sum of VLA and VN, that will be equal to VD1, and both these voltages are equal, and therefore output voltage will be equal to 0. Now in the case 2, we are considering that when the input frequency is greater than the carrier frequency, means frequency is increasing, and as per our basics, when the frequency is increasing, the capacity inductive reactance will become greater than the capacitive reactance. And because of that, the secondary circuit, which is the tuned circuit, which becomes more inductive, and therefore the secondary current is going to lag the secondary voltage by some angle of theta, and this particular theta is going to be the frequency deviation. Whatever will be the frequency deviation, by that amount the current is going to lag. And that, if we want to see in the phasor diagram, it will look like this. This is what is the secondary voltage VS. This is secondary current IS, and this is the amount of theta by which the current is lagging. Now again, if we draw a phasor diagram with this particular, then voltage VLA will be shifting towards this side, and voltage VLB will be shifting So if we take the phasor sum, vector sum of this with the primary voltage, then we will observe that VD1 is going to be more than VD2. You can see in the diagram that VD1 is more, VD2 is less, because there is some angle theta by which the current is lagging. And this is happening because of the secondary circuits become more inductive. Therefore, voltage across D1 is becoming more than D2. C1 charges more magnitude than C2, and therefore VC1 is greater than VC2, and output voltage becomes positive when the input frequency is greater than FC. And this is what you can see from this phasor diagram also, that VD1 is greater than VD2, output voltage is positive. When input frequency is less than the center frequency, frequency reduces, capacitive reactance becomes greater than inductive reactance, secondary circuit becomes more capacitive, and in the capacitive circuit, we know that current is going to lead the secondary voltage by some angle of theta, and this particular theta corresponds to frequency deviation. Now again, if we see the phasor diagram, see how it is going to be modified in this way. So here you can see this is secondary voltage Vs, this is secondary current Is, and current is leading the secondary voltage by angle of theta. And if we draw again the phasor diagram, the voltage VLB is going to be like this, and therefore if we take vector sum with the primary voltage, then VD2 is going to be greater than VD1, and therefore C2 charges more magnitude than C1. Therefore VC2 is greater than VC1, and output voltage is going to be negative. So this is how the Foster-Seeley discriminator is working. And if we see in the Foster-Seeley, when the input frequency is equal to resonance frequency, both capacity voltages are equal, output voltage is equal to zero, and phasor looks like this. When the input frequency is increasing, the circuit becomes inductive, the secondary current is going to lag the secondary voltage by some amount, by some theta, and therefore voltage VD1 is more than VD2, capacitor C1 charges more than C2, and therefore output voltage is positive. And when frequency is decreasing, that is Fin is less than FC, then capacitive reactance becomes more than inductive reactance, secondary current is going to lead the secondary voltage, voltage across diode D2 is more than D1, therefore capacitor C2 charges more, and therefore output voltage is becoming negative. And if we plot the transfer characteristics of Foster-Seeley discriminator, it will look like this. At center frequency, the output is equal to zero. At positive deviations, the output is increasing. At negative deviation, the output will decrease. And this is how the FC changes from FC to FC plus delta F, and FC changes FC to FC minus delta F. So this is the working of Foster-Seeley discriminator. The disadvantage of the Foster-Seeley discriminator is that it is going to take the weak AM signal that is too small in the amplitude to reach, and it is going to pass through a limiter stage, and this can appear at the output. So this particular circuit is able to detect small AM signal. AM signal means change in the amplitude because of the noise. And that is going to be detected by the Foster-Seeley discriminator. And this particular problem of not limiting the amplitude is going to be solved in the ratio detector, which we will be able to see in the next lecture.